أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنحون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي Dear respected elders and dear brothers and sisters in Islam and humanity, I welcome all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy, and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon all of you. The topic of my morning speech is the Vision 2050, the Islamic movement in Japan. And this is the new and the completed fresh presentation of mine. And yesterday, I proposed the common terms between Islam and the Buddhism, which is the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the best candidate for the future Buddha. And today, I'd like to focus on the common issues between Muslims and the non-Muslims in Japan. And the common issue is the economic development. When we look back to the history, like in Indonesia, Malaysia, or in Indian subcontinent, it was the traders, the business persons, who contributed much to spread the message of Islam. And if this is an indirect da'wah ilallah, but this is very crucial and very effective way of da'wah. We have a common platform between Muslim and non-Muslim get together to develop economy. And to understand the economic development, we need to deeply analyze the age and the society or social system in which we live. And in the very beginning of this morning, the first session, Dr. Zahanuddin, he proposed the Islamic banking system in general, in detail. And now I'd like to propose you the very big picture of what is going on and what kind of age and society we live in. Now, even myself, I experienced since 1997 the ITC, the revolution. The first time I used the email, it was when I was a university student, and it was in the library. And since then, so rapidly, this so-called globalization expanded. The information, the people, money, and goods, the flow, so quickly. And within just 2 decades, so many things change. But at the same time, we should also realize that our understanding cannot follow. We cannot digest so fast movement and expansion. Let's say just for 6-7 weeks, what happened in the world? I remember just I come back from America and this Muhammad Ali, he passed away. And what happened? 50 people in America were gunshot and bomb blast in the Istanbul airport, Dhaka attack, and the Medina bomb blast, and the Nice attack. Then just yesterday, before yesterday, this Turkey coup d'etat. It has so many things happened, so many things. And who can actually follow what really happened, the reality, the fact? We cannot digest it. It's so many things happen so quickly. And the money also moves so fast beyond borders. The billion dollars is moving every second. So we need to stop and think what kind of society we are in and how to deal with this high speed, the movement. And the major principle, this social system, is a capitalism. And this capitalist system is basically is the maximization of the enterprise profit. So this is a motivation, is a very basic principle of capitalism, and based on this, this society is moving. And now, this new globalization, this capital, the profit, even transcend the national borders before even the country can control. But now, particularly after the Lehman Shock, or just before after Lehman Shock, the capital, the financial, this market is become so grow and so big. The real economy is become so small and not tangible. I mean, become not so important. So when we see this mega trend, the global main player is multinational companies. So even the, like, let's say in Japan, like Toyota, alone, the budget, so-called revenue, is more than the 5 times as many as the budget of national budget of Bangladesh. And it is more similar to the Russia. Or just one company. One company has so much money, more than the country national budget. And this multinational company come to the new market, and particularly nowadays, even Japanese company go to Indonesia or Malaysia or other countries, Muslim majority countries, to open the market, to open their factories, and then to absorb the economic growth of their countries. And before we have the G7, but now it's G20 era. Saudi Arabia there, Indonesia also there. So the key players we can find is more and more the multipolarization now we are facing. And when we go back to the origin of this, the world globalization, is so many the political changes already happened before. Just after the World War II and during the 60s and 70s, it is called the Cold War between Soviet Union and then America. This is the conflict of ideology between the communism or socialist ideology and capitalism. And after the collapse of the Soviet Union, the America is become superpower, is the only power who can control. And their major force is the financial debt growth. So it's finally, it leads to the 2008 so-called the Lehman Shock. This already explained in the morning. So I'm not explaining detail. But this is all the history for the past 40, 50 years. And after the fall of this supreme financial-led economy, the America losing power. And then now the new power, Asia, is come. Now has come. On the other hand, recently we observed the EU crisis. Just recently there is in UK, the EU referendum, whether stay or out. So the new nationalism is came. So the British people, they select out EU. So EU, their ideology is to unite the regionally, the politically, no, sorry, economically and the currency. And their idea is great, but reality is that they more and more, they boost their nationalism, it seems like. And because the, within the EU, the country's economic power is so different. The Greeks and Spain, they are economically very weak. Their unemployment rate is very high compared to Germany, for example. It is very small, the figure.
Can you see? Oh, sorry. Oh, it's difficult. This is a figure. This is a Greek
The unemployment is 27%, and Spain is 24.4, while the Germany is only 4.8. And a lot of debt, the national debt, this the Greek and the Spanish. So within the same EU, but difference. So how to adjust this difference? Those who have no job in the Greek or the Spain, they come to Germany, they come to UK, because there are so many jobs. But those who are local, they don't like. They don't like because they will deprive their job, the potential threat. And there is a structure changes within Asia. It's a long history, just for 2 decades, the many things happened. Like Indonesia after Suharto, 1998, the reformacy. Many things happened and unstable. Even I was not expecting that Indonesia grow so economically. And unless until the Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono came in power and then reigned for 10 years, he stabilized the economy and dramatically changed. Now this Jokowi, he is running, but there is some issues. But already so-called took off, the Indonesia took off to the growth. And the many political changes, even in Myanmar recently, the NLD and came into power, and the military, they officially, they are not the main power. So many changes politically happened. And this support the liberalization and the boost, the backup, the globalization. And this political change, in fact, influenced and then create a rapid growth of Asia. Now, this is a data in just 5-6 years ago, 2010. The entire growth, the GDP growth of Asia, is supersede all areas. This Asia, including Japan. So because of the power of China and India, now the growth more than North America and Europe. So I can safely say that now the age of Asia, the power is coming again to the so-called entire Asia. So even in Japan, it is not just think about the Islamic movement in Japan, but have to see a part of Asia. We have to see the Japan as a part of Asia. We have to see the Islamic movement as a part of Asia. And this is a history, is since 1500 to up to the early 20th century. It's a very beginning. China and then India has so much power here. When we see the real GDP, USA is only $800 million at that time, 1500. At that time in China was $61,800 million. It's all a giant. But later on, after passing time, then here, from this 19th century, early 20th century, it's become U.S. became so much power, it's more than double the budget and the major, the GDP. So now the power shift, just the beginning of 20th century, and then now China back, and India also back, because of population growth. And America lose power because of this Lehman shock and the financial crisis. And this is what we call emerging economies, the Goldman Sachs, the American financial institution. They analyzed in 2005. There is 11 promising economic the growing countries in the world, the 11. And among 11, there are seven Muslim majorities. For example, Indonesia, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Iran, and Egypt, and Turkey, Nigeria. These seven countries, they are very potential, highly potential. The country which will develop their economy so rapidly for the next 45 years until 2050. And this is a figure that when we compare this next 11, I mentioned next 11. Next 11, the growth is quite stable up to 2050. Its average is more than like 5% annual growth. It's a very big growth. And for the just until 2020, for the next decade, actually this decade, is the BRICS goes very up, but later on going down. But next 11 is still high, the development. Because of population bonus, these countries have enough population. The population is the main source of economy because this population become a labor force as well as they will consume the goods. In Japan, why losing economic power? Because no children, no population. The population decrease, so naturally economy power decrease. For example, it's a very simple, if you do not have family, I mean children, you don't have to buy house, you don't have to buy car, for example, just you assume alone or just have wife. Maybe you don't need any transportation, big car, big house, and you don't have to buy the clothes for children, and then, you know, for the educational cost. You don't have to spend. So naturally, there is no growth. But if you have many children, alhamdulillah, Muslim countries have many children, right? So naturally, they have to spend a lot. So it will boost the economy. I mean, it will generate the capital flow. And as I explained, here are the factors that influence GDP growth is the labor force and capital and the productivity. So naturally, the people come uneducated and the productivity increase. So the country goes, you know, that develop. And in fact, Japan is want to be a part of Asia because this is an interdependency era. So they want to take the growth of Asia into the Japanese economy. This is a strategy. And this is the interest of the Japanese people. That's why there must be a common ground between Muslim and non-Muslims. And you see that this is the prediction for the next up to the 2050. The population, the Asia, is so big, 5.23 billion it will be by 2050. And the other kind of Africa also become like almost double. And we can see that Africa also there are many Muslims. And the other part of the world is not so big, just only billion. The major growth is Asia and Africa. Particularly Asia, the absolute majority is Asia. It's more than 60, nearly 70%, the whole population. It's become very dominant. And very soon, the India will be the number one. It will surpass the population of China very soon. This is a projection for 2050, but India is number one, and there is no specific statistics, but there are many Muslims in India. Some people say it's 15%, some people say 20%, but the total number is so big, so Muslim number population is so big. And China also. We have China local Muslims, Hui Hui, we call Hui Hui, or Uyghur. Uyghur, yes. They are suppressed, unfortunately. But they are a big number. and USA, Pakistan, Nigeria, these all countries, this Nigeria, Indonesia, Bangladesh, these are all the next 11 countries. This is just projection, but is according to the statistics, the growth, the fertility rate they projected. Maybe it will be more, maybe. So we can see that all the power is goes to the Asia, shifting to Asia. And expansion middle income class, especially emerging economies. So now what is going on, like in Indonesia also, in Bangladesh also, in the capital city, there are so many, you know, the tall buildings, many, many buildings now. Is the land cost so increased and they develop so rapidly and super modern. And if you go outside from the capital city, it becomes like a pre-modern area, like only the field, petty field, like the middle age. Is nothing developed, but only the very big capital developed so fast. And because this middle income, this generation, this class grow, and they come to the big city and consume. And they become major workforce and they develop. And they can purchase the something, you know, a bit luxurious things, the car or houses. So they will purchase something which they couldn't purchase before. And the population wise, in the world total is almost more than double, 4.88 billion people, that is middle income class. In the 2030, this is a 2030 projection. That, and then, therefore, the mutual ties between so-called the non-Muslim countries and then Muslim countries or emerging economies is become strong, deepening. So they are more and more interdependent. And when we see this right side, the figure, the increased income major developed countries from overseas investment. So the so-called developed countries, they come to the emerging economy, the companies, they invest a lot, they invest. So during investment, there must be interaction, there must be. And this is a platform for DAWA too. Many companies come to Japan too. So that will be a platform for DAWA. Because if you have just the lecture about Islam, not many people will attend it. But maybe if it is the matter of business conference, it will be held in Muslim countries. Japanese or non-Muslim will come, and of course Muslim also come. This will be a common platform, and it will be a very good opportunity for Dawah. Not necessarily just you talk about Tawheed from the beginning, but you put the Tawheed in your back of your head, and at the end of the day, you can just, you know, explain just only one word or two words to click their mind. It will be effective, inshallah. Because unless you meet, there no dawah, you no communication, then no dawah. So first, how you invite a non-Muslim to the common platform is a major issue. And this is another issue, so-called shale gas revolution in the USA. Before, the USA depended on Middle East oil, but now they found so-called shale gas. They have so much reserve oil in America. So they are not so much now interested in the so-called Arab oils. That's why they retreat their military. They do not want to involve Middle East so much. They lost so many soldiers' life. So now what's the benefit? In fact, just supporting the Israel is not, the people cannot support. The government cannot sustain their credibility and accountability just based on where they have to support Israel. Before there is an oil profit, I mean oil interest, that's why they have very good reason to invade. But now they found their own oil, so what to do? That's why even politically it will be important, and in this the America retreat from the Middle East is create more turmoil in the Middle East. This is just the projection. And a new world power structure, the multipolarization. Before, the superpower is just America. But now China comes, India comes, that's the other Asia countries comes. So many people, so many countries, or the multinational companies, they gain power. So this power becomes more and more individualized. So it will become so-called is a new world power structure. So in 21st century, so this is expected surge of economic zone. Okay, huge population. So there is a majority of the country involved and reach to the certain stage of economic development. So they have their own voice more loudly. Also, so now what they will do? These countries want to have a regional cooperation so that they can get more and more power. This is a kind of the exclusion. So how they can be better than other areas. So this is a competition. Now from this year, AEC, the ASEAN Economic Community, was already launched. So their agenda is to unite the economically, this ASEAN. This ASEAN. They want to go further. Not ASEAN, but AEC. They want to unite the currency. There are so many hurdles. And Japan also wants to be one of them. But there are so many issues. But anyway, it's already launched. So this is my future prospects or prediction. In 2050, in Japan, is definitely what will happen is the Asian community, Asian Muslim community. In other words, there is more and more Asian immigrants will come. And even present day, there is, when I check the statistics of Ministry of Justice, about 110,000 to maximum 130,000 so-called Muslims. It depends on the population from India, they are Muslim or not, I cannot see. But if there is, without the Muslim count in Indian immigrants here, then 110,000. But if including Indian immigrants, there are many so-called Muslims, then it will be like 130,000. Now, but later on, after 35 years, what will happen? The projection. After I analyze the past 5 years of the demographic change of immigrants in Japan, it will be like 460,000 to 660,000 Muslim immigrants here in Japan. And the most striking the point is the travelers. There are many travelers now, particularly from Malaysia, Indonesia, and Turkey. This is the biggest three travelers. So many travelers come. So they, as if, because so many travelers, so they, we can also count them as the immigrant, looks like they're staying in Japan on the spot. So when we see the growth of the travelers, 100,000 every year increase for the last 4 years. After the relaxation of the visa of Indonesia or Malaysia, many people come. And if this visa relaxation happens for other countries, Muslim countries, more and more Muslims will come, more visit. So on the spot, this about 3.5 million Muslim travelers. This is an increase for the next 35 years. And in total, it will be about 5 million, including other nationalities, and including this present, about 500,000 Muslim travelers. It will become like 5 million Muslim travelers. So it is quite big. By year, by monthly, if we divide, is about 420,000 Muslims every month on the spot. So including the immigrants who are staying in Japan, about 1 million 1 million Muslim will be somehow in Japan on the spot. So within this the projection, we can see that the growth of Muslim businesses and the investments, and through advanced skill, the professionals in Japan, the Japanese society will be influenced much because of the outside force, not from inside. This is how Japan opened the country after the isolation of Japan during Tokugawa era, because of this black sheep came and then opened the country's economy. So they are reluctant, but they opened the country. So likewise, when this force of Asian economic growth come to Japan, many people, maybe reluctantly, but they try to adapt this social change. And they will sit with Muslim to discuss how to develop the economy. So that will be a platform. For example, we will need these kind of professionals soon later, the legal experts, those who are well-versed in Islamic and modern law, but because of halal issue, employment issue, and therefore the visa. And next one is a financial business professional. Like in the first lesson is talking about Islamic banking. Why you have questions? Why this is attractive for the non-Muslim? Because that is a platform for the investment for the non-Muslims. For the Muslim to invest in Japan. Because through if we have Sharia bank here in Japan, Middle East, the billionaires, they can invest Japan through that Sharia bank. And that's why there is a common platform. The millionaire can benefit, and even the Sharia bank in Japan can benefit. And the property business also same. When the population grow, naturally people want to have the housing. Now, there is no option to have the house without loan. So people are just renting. And then after paying 30 years, 40 years, and then finally, this will not be your property. So this is definitely is not meeting the Muslims' demand. The Muslims want to acquire the property so that they can build the community, the town, Muslim town. Unless they cannot acquire the land, how you can physically establish the business, a Muslim town? It's difficult. That's why it becomes for the investment too. The foreign Muslim living outside Japan, they can also invest through this property business and the so-called the Sharia-based. And the medical doctors, the Sharia hospitals. Alhamdulillah, we are aged society here. So, in fact, in terms of medical equipment and the services, in Japan is very good. It's very popular. Then why not you create a medical tourism? You invite someone who suffered some disease, you know, operation, serious operation. So some people will come to Japan for operation. And if this is Sharia-based hospital, then why not? If it is not Sharia-based, then many people have reluctant to come. And the next one is finally need the politician parliament members within Japan to change the legislation. Because for the banking system and for the property or even the medical services, maybe there is a hindrance in the law, present law. So naturally, we need the politicians, parliament member, not necessarily maybe Muslim, ideally maybe Muslim, but even non-Muslim, but who can agree on these agendas? Even non-Muslim can support for change of legislation. And finally, the target is to build the Khaira Ummah of Asian Muslim. So because we follow the Sharia, and if we implement what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, economically and socially, this society will be khair, the good, inshallah. So I'd like to end my talk with a quotation from Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 110. كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تعملون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. You are the best ummah ever raised for mankind because you enjoy what is right and you forbid what is wrong and believe in Allah. و da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.